So there's a little Imelda in all of us.
For 2,200 pairs of shoes.
3,000 pairs of shoes.
2,600 pairs of shoes.
2,200 pairs of shoes.
1,200 of shoes here.
They're kid skin, they're really, really soft. And I actually imagine that these probably belonged to probably quite a young girl rather than a woman. If you look at the top of them, they're just so tiny. Almost, you know, our wrists wouldn't fit in them, they're so small. And then the second pair that we have are a pair of women's walking boots. And something that happens in the 1900s is prior to the late 1800s, when women were inside predominantly and they were really prized for very, very narrow feet, in the 1900s women become a lot more mobile, they start walking around, so they need much more practical footwear, and I think that's what these boots really illustrate. They're sort of a lot larger, they're wider, and they've got a much lower heel than the sort of thing that you would have been walking around all day in. And also another thing that you have to remember is that most people's shoes were covered at this time, you know, hemlines were still to the floor. So you wouldn't really have seen these, you would have just gotten a flash of leather. So shoes as a decorative item probably weren't quite as important as they were in later decades.
FYI, I'm being out Imelded.
Okay, so this is the 1910s. We have one very beautiful pair of shoes for this era. And they're a pair of brown suede pumps. They've got a Louis heel, which is a very sort of curved hourglass heel. And the thing that's really interesting about these shoes is that there's no distinguishing between left and right. They're both exactly the same, which is really, really interesting. And again, they're just so, so narrow. And we've got a great image from this time that illustrates the difference between the silhouette of the 1900s versus the silhouette of the 1910s. So you've got a designer like Faure who starts designing at this time, and the hemline starts to rise. So you can see her very beautiful shoes in that image. And these, of course, would have been seen. So they're much more decorative and much more feminine as well. So these are our shoes from the 1920s. We have five very beautiful pairs. And I think my favourite are probably the red silk dance shoes. And the dance shoe, of course, is probably the main silhouette of this time. Hemlines have risen even higher. They're just below the knee. And the leg becomes a real focus in the 1920s. You've got the flapper, so you've got this silhouette. It's very, very streamlined, very modern. And so shoes are, again, very, very high. Details in these shoes. The leathers become, you know, opalescent, they become pressed. Silks and satins are used in lots of pink things. So they're very, very beautiful. And the heel is higher again, so you have that silhouette of very, very beautiful legs. I love these with beads. They're just beautiful. I mean, you can imagine someone dancing the night away in a pair of these quite comfortably.
What's really hard to capture on film is just how small these are.
Yeah, they're absolutely tiny, and you don't really get a sense of that until you see them and you actually get a sense of them in person, because when we photograph them, you just don't get a sense of that. There is one pair, actually, the cream pair, that is sort of quite large for that time, but generally, I mean, to us now, they look like children's shoes, you know, they're just absolutely tiny. And women were a lot smaller as well. I mean, I think that's something that we forget. It's not, you know, it's not that they were the size of us with really small feet. They were just proportionately much smaller.
Yeah.
So the shoes are as well, of course. shoes from the 1930s. I think probably my favourites are these silk mules from the department store Bonwitella, and they're just wonderful bright colours, and colour is something that's really, really important in the 1930s. You have a really large influence from film at this time, so you get very, very beautiful ornate heels, screen siren sort of shoes, and I think too the gold pumps here are really, really indicative of that sort of silhouette, very decorative. They've got a beautiful buckle closure with rhinestones in it. So all of those sort of details become really, really heightened in the 1930s. It's very, very glamorous. And down the bottom, we're moving on to the 1940s. So of course, in the 40s, there's the influence of the war, but there's also, I think, because of the glamour of the 1930s, people still really want to hold on to that. So you've got, you know, real resourcefulness with materials to make things that are still very beautiful, but are within the realms of, you know, rationing and things like that. So again, in the 1940s, this idea of materials becomes really important. So you get a lot of snake skin because it's something that's a lot easier to find. It's not rationed in the same way. And you also have wonderful things like these platforms that actually have nail heads as their decoration. So the sort of the idea of hardware is literal. You know, you've actually got nails being used, but they don't, you know, to us now, they don't look like nails. They look like just gold studs. And colour is important as well. Often leathers are dyed when possible. I love these, they're really, really bright pink and purple. The colour is just amazing. And this pair of David Evans heels from the 1940s as well. They've got the low chunky heel, which is a really, really important silhouette at the time. Again, you know, women have to be practical. You don't have very high heels because they're out working and walking around.
The 50s. Okay,
so this is the 1950s, which is in huge contrast to the 1940s. The war ends in the mid-1940s. We have the influence of Christian Dior's new look. And for this new silhouette, there really needs to be new shoes as well. Women don't want to wear chunky, practical heels anymore. They want to wear something that's really glamorous, really beautiful. And a lot of the key designers at the time, people like Roger Vivier, are working to create a really, really slim heel. And the stiletto gets created in about 1954. Lots of people say they created it. We don't really know definitively who it was. But we've got some really beautiful examples in the exhibition. I think my favorite are the Herbert Levine purple satin, very, very high stiletto heels. And you can just imagine someone in their beautiful Christian Dior dress with the big, big skirt. And again, with these Roger Viviers that we have from this time too, a beautiful pair of slingbacks. So again, at this time, something that happens is the narrow foot becomes quite important again. And these shoes obviously aren't as narrow as the shoes that were from sort of previous times. But the foot looks more narrow because of the very, very pointed silhouette again. So it's that very, very feminine ideal rather than...
But we weren't having women lopping off their toes.
No. And I think that's something that's really, really tied, especially to the late 1800s, when women were inside. They didn't have to be walking around. They could just sit down and look pretty, and that's what they were wanted for. So it didn't matter if you were missing a toe. You didn't have to walk around. But we have to walk around now, so there's no more lopping off of toes. Okay, we have a few more pairs of 1950s. We have this beautiful pair of Schiaparelli shoes from the 1950s. It's got her signature pink label inside. We have some beautiful hand-painted brown.
These are stunning.
Yeah.
Again, it's really hard to...
It is, yeah. Do you want me to move this?
Maybe go a little closer. There we go.
I love these, the golden plastic shoes. So plastic, of course, is something that's really, really big in the 1950s and 60s. It's sort of this new innovation and everybody wants to have it in everything. And there's a lot of plastic shoes from the 1950s, and they're sort of they're kind of tacky, but they're kind of Cinderella slippery as well. I really love them. And these are just so outrageous. I mean, they look like they could be from the 1980s.
Yeah, these have got like such an 80s feel to them, don't they?
Yeah.